The saxophonist David Sanborn presents the first in a series about one of the most influential composers, arrangers and bandleaders of the 20th century, Gil Evans. The programme contains some strong language.
I go way back before radio even, you know what I mean? Where people, everybody had their own piano in the home, you know, and they'd play all the songs. And I moved to Berkeley, California when I was about 15, went to Berkeley High, and I met a boy in school, took me home to his house, and his father had fixed a rumpus room for him, you know, and he had a piano and a set of drums and a record player, and this was in 1927, man. Well, I had never heard jazz, so he played me these records, and I fell in love with the music, you know. I actually learned music from Louis Armstrong. The first record of his I bought was in 1927, when he was working with Earl Hines, you know, and Don Redman wrote the arrangement called No One Else But You, and it's motherfucker, man, wow. I played it for Miles one time, he couldn't believe it. He had never heard Louis Armstrong play like that, you know. But I learned music from him, how to approach a song, you know. The way he sang them and played them, they became magic moments, you know. On all those old 78 records that only last 3 minutes, somewhere in one of the, on that 3 minutes would be a magic moment, right? Great. So anyway, I learned from Louis Armstrong, so as a result, trumpet is my favorite instrument.
In the six decades that followed his discovery of Louis Armstrong, Gil Evans dedicated himself to creating a lifetime of his own magic moments. He's, of course, best known as an arranger. Now, in that role, he's broadened the palette of colors available to jazz musicians. He gave us a new spectrum to work with, a different way of using harmony and texture. My name's David Sanborn, and over the next 3 weeks, I'll be joined by a host of Gil's musical friends to try to recapture some magic moments and to paint for you some sketches of Gil.
There's something no one else has got, Mama, except you. I found that something I have sought, Mama, in you. When it comes to loving, you got in it. One kiss, all my heart would beat 1,000 miles a minute. I never seeked another sheep except you. Someday I'll bid a little tan just for two. Oh, you treat me like a child. Oh, God, simply wild. And it's over, no one else but you.
Gil Evans was born Ernest Gilmore Green in Toronto in 1912. An only child, his mother told him that he'd fallen from a star and that she'd found him on a beach. Now, according to him, up until the age of 12, he had no reason to doubt her. This kind of poetic approach to daily life would stay with Gil until his death in 1988. It was as if fact and fiction swam together in his head, and it was more important to, that what came out should be truly beautiful than absolutely true. By the time Gil reached adulthood, his love for the music of Louis Armstrong had driven him to take up the piano. And by the early 1930s, he was leading a semi-pro big band in Stockton, California. Performing piano solos wasn't his focus. He played more of an accompanist role and was responsible for developing the band's repertoire, a book of pop and some jazz tunes, which he'd transcribed from the radio. In 1936, his group got a regular slot at a hotel in Balboa, Southern California, and the band's reputation began to grow steadily. But after a couple of years, the gig suddenly dried up. Then, in early 1938, Gil was presented with a very tempting offer. A young singer named Skinny Ennis, who'd started out as a drummer with Hal Kemp's band, was looking for a ready-made backing group to put his name to. Now, Gil had a difficult choice to make, to give control over to Skinny and to stay on as an arranger, or to risk losing his group altogether. Well, Gil chose to go with Skinny, which led to the band's first studio date and Gil's debut recording as an arranger and pianist.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to tell you the story of the girlfriend of the whirling dervish. They tell me a whirling dervish is a Bombay gate who, through simply whirling and uncurling, makes those Hindu jitterbugs blow their oriental tops. I think we all know what a girlfriend is, so here goes. She's the girlfriend of the whirling dervish. She's the sweetest one he's found. But every night in the mellow moonlight, when he's out dervishing with all his might, she gives him the run around. All the boyfriends of the whirling dervish are his best friends to his face. But there's no doubt when he is slipped out, they all come hurrying to take her out. She leaves him a dizzy face. He dreams of a Hindu honeymoon. He doesn't dream that every night when he goes out to make an honest whoopee, she steps out to make a lot of whoopee.
Whoopee.
The Skinny Ennis Orchestra and the Girlfriend of the Whirling Dervish, recorded in autumn 1938. While Gil may have spent years grooming the band into a tight working unit, it was Skinny's quirky vocal style that brought commercial success. It soon caught the ear of Hollywood comedian and disc jockey Bob Hope, who hired them to be the house band on his weekly radio show. As an arranger, Gil had to come up with the scores to fit the stylistic needs of each week's show. The experience put immense pressure on Gil and turned him off commercial writing for life. But it also led to a key meeting when the Hope organization drafted another writer to help Gil with the arrangements. His name was Claude Thornhill. A few years older than Gil, Thornhill had already written a couple of chart hits for Benny Goodman and was considered one of the best vocal arrangers in the business. But Claude also found Hope's radio show to be creatively stifling and very soon left to start his own band. And in early 1940, the Claude Thornhill Orchestra was born. Gil followed the rise of Thornhill with great interest, as did another young up-and-coming musician, Gunther Schuller.
In those days, it was incumbent upon every swing band to create its own individual sound. I mean, after all, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of bands in the United States before the war and during the war. And in order for you to stand out at all, you had to sort of invent your own sound. And that's how the Glenn Miller sound came to be, the Count Basie sound, and all these different sonorities and conceptions. And but Thornhill's was really going in an entirely different direction, whereas most jazz orchestras were very strong on the brass side and the brassy sounds and the bright sounds. Thornhill, with his, he sometimes had seven clarinets in his orchestra that produced a quite different sound, and that was the whole way that that band distinguished itself.
Over the course of the 1940s, Thornhill continued to expand his orchestra further, adding two French horns and then tuba, instruments seldom heard before in jazz. Thornhill wrote the early arrangements for the orchestra himself, such as Snowfall, which became the band's theme song. Then when he got a booking to play New York's Glen Island Casino in 1941, he invited Gil to become a full-time arranger with the band. Now, for Gil, this was a dream come true, and he left Skinny Ennis in a flash. With a vast and very rich array of colors to use in his arrangements, Gil was held back only by his limited knowledge of music theory, which he taught himself largely by listening to the compositions of Duke Ellington and Fletcher Henderson.
Well, by the time I got to New York, then I was interested in the Impressionists, right? I liked that, and I needed a harmonic language, because up until that time I only had just the regular jazz and pop language, you know, like Fletcher and Duke and all everybody. So I went to the public library then when I came to New York and used to take the scores and bring them home. And sometimes I'd stay up all night and copy the whole score and then make it into a concert from the transpose it all just to learn it. So then I got my harmonic language from Debussy and Ravel and Mussorgsky and, you know, all the Impressionists. So I got a chance to use that language with Claude Thornhill. But I still needed some more harmony, you know, some harmony with some an edge to it, you know, spice to it.
The 1940s would provide Gil with no shortage of spice. Now, when the U.S. entered the Second World War in 1942, it had as much impact on jazz as on any other part of American life. Both Claude and Gil were drafted into the Army, and for the next 3 years, Gil was forced to limit his study of harmony to the occasional peek at his trusty Cecil Forsyth book on orchestration, which, legend has it, he kept stuffed into his combat jacket. Now, in 1946, after the war finished, Gil returned to pick up where he left off with Claude Thornhill, submitting pieces such as The Troubadour, based on Mussorgsky's Pictures at an Exhibition. Now, around this time, the orchestra was joined by a young alto saxophonist named Lee Konitz.
This was really the first so-called name band, and I was coming out of Chicago for the first time to do that. Claude Thornhill was kind of a shy man. He didn't stand in front of the band, really, just sat at the piano, mostly playing. And it was very easy to be around. And I think that was reflected in the way the band played. But Gil was like a co-leader somehow. He was, you know, like a guru character. He was kind of stoned all the time. And he was able to stretch it out and make it more interesting, much more interesting. There were times when could hardly hold back goose pimples. The band sounded so beautiful. The Happy Stranger, arranged by Gil Evans and recorded by the Claude Thornhill Orchestra in December 1947. The decade had seen major changes take place in jazz. Now, the story normally goes something like this. Having evolved from early jazz, swing music became a more populous, dance-floor-friendly style. The musicians became more and more complacent and forgot that jazz was supposed to be about invention.
Then in the early 1940s, a new sound was heard coming from various New York basement clubs that were largely frequented by young black players. And before long, bebop was born. It was fast, creative, and fiendishly difficult to master. It might have seemed strange then to see a tall, thin, white Canadian walk into one of these clubs and be visibly awestruck and immediately resolve to incorporate the bebop sound into his own big band. But this is near enough what happened. Now, by 1947, Gil had reworked three Charlie Parker tunes for the Claude Thornhill Orchestra. This new direction would be met by mixed reaction when Gil presented the material to the players.
It was, for the most part, a very well-playing band. It's just there were mostly, I would say, swing musicians, and learning to play the bebop, which Gil introduced, was a little bit awkward for them, I think. He taught the people how to phrase the bebop lines and very patiently got them to play pretty close to the way that stuff should go, I thought. But it was never entirely comfortable to me somehow. In that situation, when I had a little solo to play, I just did what I knew I knew best. And when I listened back to the records, I think, my goodness, maybe I should have played like Charlie Parker. But that was it. I tried, and I guess that was the way I heard it at the time.
Lee Konitz wasn't the only one to feel awkward about this new direction. Claude Thornhill, too, had some reservations.
He had a problem. His main problem was really that he didn't like bebop. He liked bebop okay, but he didn't want it to be in his band. So when we started playing some bebop songs, he did them all. He was a good sport about it, too. We recorded Donna Lee and Anthropology and all, and Yardbird Suite and all that, and Claude was a really what you call a good sport about it. He went along with it, but he didn't want to do it, so we stopped. That's when he fired me.
Luckily, by the time Gil parted company from Claude Thornhill in 1948, he'd made plenty of friends who did like bebop. And with a basement flat near 52nd Street, he hardly had to get out of bed to help initiate what would become a revolution in jazz.
I rented this room, and I left the door open for 2 years. Just left it open, literally. So people just came down to that. It was just like one room, but I had everything in there. I had a piano, a record player, and one of the early recorders, a great big machine that Claude Thornhill gave it to me. So I had all that there, and plus a wild interest, and we'd get together and compare notes and chords and all that, and sounds, and that's how I got together with Miles Davis.
And right now, ladies and gentlemen, back to the Royal Roost, where the lights are low, the music with that gone groove, right here at 1580 Broadway between 47th and 48th Street, that's right opposite the Strand Theater, where you can sit back and relax and dig some of the wonderful things. And right now, ladies and gentlemen, we bring you something new in modern music. We bring you Impressions in Modern Music with the great Miles Davis and his wonderful new organization, featuring Max Roach on drums, John Lewis on piano, Al McKibben on bass, Lee Konitz on alto, Jerry Mulligan on baritone, Bill Barber on tuba, Junior Collins on French horn, and Mike Zwerin on trombone. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a big hand for something new in modern jazz. Ladies and gentlemen, the Miles Davis Organization, as they do for you a John Lewis arrangement, their first tune, a thing called Move.
Miles Davis later said that Gil Evans could use four instruments where other arrangers needed eight. And with the new Miles Davis organization, also known as the Miles Davis Nonette, the aim was to do just that. Taking the core concept of the Thornhill Orchestra, as well as some of the key players, they form a slimmed-down version with Miles as the lead voice. Gil and some of his buddies from his Manhattan flat, John Lewis, Jerry Mulligan, and John Carisi, provided the arrangements, and Miles himself called rehearsals, hired the halls, and generally cracked the whip. It was Miles also, through his association with Charlie Parker, who was able to secure the band a two-week stint at the Royal Roost in November 1948, and a series of follow-up sessions for Capitol Records a year later. Gunther Schuller played French horn on some of these sessions.
The idea was to emulate that velvety sound that Gil Evans got in his arrangements with the Claude Thornhill Orchestra, and the two French horns were a large part of that new sound. There were more low-register instruments in the Nonette than there were high-register. In fact, there were no high-register instruments. The highest instruments were a trumpet and alto. And the range of the alto stopped at the top of the staff, and Miles could play a few high Cs now and then. But so basically, between the baritone, two horns, and tuba, this was a kind of dark or warm sound created by this Nonette. That's why it incidentally became to be called cool, although it isn't just cool. It isn't cool like West Coast jazz became cool, which became sort of almost intellectual with its polyphonic workings and writing. But the cooled off sound and the warm sound was the main point of it.
On the track Moon Dreams, Gil wrote a coda, so to speak, that was totally unusually beautiful. Everybody was moving in a different direction, and it was very difficult to play. And it was very classical sounding, and it just felt like another dimension to so-called jazz orchestration.
Moon Dreams, recorded by the Miles Davis Nonette in March 1950, and one of a series of 78 RPM singles released later that year. Now, although they'd achieved cult status when they were released as the album Birth of the Cool later on that decade, when they were initially released, the records were a total flop. Now, rather than building on their cutting-edge concepts, Miles and Gil spent the next 5 years or so struggling to rediscover their creative flow. Next week, I'll be picking up the story of the duo in 1957, when the two were reunited in the studio under the enterprising hand of George Avakian from Columbia Records to record the three long-playing albums that would, in short, change the face of music. I'm talking about Miles Ahead, Porgy and Bess, and Sketches of Spain. Avakian had seen what had happened when the Thornhill Orchestra was slimmed down for the Miles Davis Nonette, and he offered Gil the chance to go the other way and expand the Thornhill sound. Now, with free rein on instrumentalists, it's said that Gil just kept counting till he reached 19. Hence the subtitle for Miles Ahead. Their first Columbia recording was Miles Plus 19. I'll leave you with Springsville from this album. First, though, a final thought from Lee Konitz, who played alto on Miles Ahead, and who, like Miles, would remain an important collaborator for the rest of Gil's life.
Another thing comes to mind. I can't help talking about the pot smoking, because that was happening, you know, and we're out of the closet now with that, I think. And we would sit in the dressing room, and he had a big bowl of a pipe that he used. And I was not smoking. And someone came into the dressing room. They wouldn't figure that one of us was not smoking because the place stunk. And there I was. So I said one night, to hell with it, give me some. And I learned how to tap dance that night. So it works.
Part of Springsville, performed by Miles Davis, plus 19 from the 1957 album Miles Ahead, ending this week's Jazz File. Sketches of Gil was presented by David Sanborn and produced by Joby Waldman. The programme is a Something Else production for BBC Radio 3, and you can hear the next instalment of the Gil Evans story at the same time next Saturday.